process of creating all of online work in your classes now?
Well, I finished all of that last week, but that's just the
That's like that's the number of YouTube.
Just see if you can figure that out. Like,
YouTube, Mary Frances Early Palace.
Let's get comfortable and familiar. There are people in the back that may want to scoot up. You can stand against that wall. Raise your hand if you see a space open next to you where like other people could sit down. And you know, if you're comfortable on the floor, we can lock this door. Is there air conditioning? It feels a little warm, but you could make people not come in here and then you could populate this area. Get comfortable. That is a campaign in Athens. Hi, everyone. Give yourselves applause. You're here. Oh my gosh. We made it. This is, someone take pictures. I'm going to take your picture. Because I've not seen this many people for poetry. And I'm going to get you guys first. And then everyone smile over here. Wow. You win. We win. I'm so excited, and I'm very honored to have Amanda Shannon next to me interpreting for all the bilinguals in the room and for all of the those of us who wish to be bilingual. Nice, applause, yeah, this is the ASL. Wait, give applause, I'm not doing it very well. I hope you're doing it better. We're here with gratitude to so many people. One, I want to give out a shout out to our Athens Clark County Library System. They are awesome. They do so much for the community. They welcome everyone into their doors. And when I said, let's write a grant and have this come through the library to the National Endowment for the Arts, they said yes. And I'm so, they've said yes many times before. And they are just marvelous to work with. And they're such a resource in our community. So just gratitude to the library. I want to tell you that we have events for big people, which most of you are, I think, grown-ups. And if you're not, awesomer, if you're young people. If you're really young people or you know young people, we are focused on celebrating poetry, the poetry in particular of Ilya Kaminsky and Katie Farris tonight, as well as just in general what it means to be in the arts, abled and in a disabled and abled body. And we're going to do a big, big event at the Georgia Museum of Art on May 13th, giving out three beautiful picture books. This is one of them. This one is I'm Not a Label, 34 Disabled Artists, Thinkers, Athletes, and Activists from Past to Present. So this book is great for all ages. Please come. I brought a lot of books, and I'd like to give them away for free to a lot of you and your beloved ones. So come. We're going to have ASL lessons from Professor Leffler, and we're going to have guide dogs and art, and it'll be a great event. And then we're also going to have the film CODA, Child of Deaf Adults, which is a brilliant Academy Award film from 2022, and we're screening that in the evening of May 15th. And around the room, you'll see different things that'll help you know about these events. Tonight, we get to hear beautiful music and poetry. I am Melissa Kahneman-Taylor. I'm from the College of Education. I am also grateful to my college for letting me do these wonderful things that bring the arts and education together with you in community. I am grateful to my colleague, Ron Braxley, who is back there live streaming this performance. Is it live streamable, accessible? How does one do that?
So there's a link to a YouTube link that you can just access.
But like, can I say, go to the College of Ed? Well, I don't know how you access it, but I know we are live streaming. And I believe that that means that we will be able to see it later.
Oh boy, Etornavenki.
This next song is from Croatia. Called Latila Zozulia, and it's also about being in love with someone who's dark and handsome, but unfortunately this time it's the wrong person. He has a wife and two dark-haired children, so it's a little bit sad.
Latila Zozulia, share more you kahatu. Oh,
Translation goes something like this. Can you teach me how to push the peppers deep, deep, deep into the ground so that they will flower and bear much fruit? Why, yes, I can.
It's about farming.
It's definitely just
it's
about farming.
Dil mano, dil pero. Dil mano, dil pero, kaži mi kak si sari pipero, kaži mi kak si sari pipero. Dil mano, dil pero, dil mano, dil pero, kaži mi kak si sari pipero, kaži mi kak si sari pipero. Da šuti da verže, da šuti da verže, da bereš, 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 kak sakaš, da bereš, 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 kak sakaš, da bereš, 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 kak sakaš, da bereš, 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 kak sakaš. Pomoc mi go, pomoc mi go, pomoc mi go, pomoc mi go, era kak si sari, sari pipero, era kak si sari, sari pipero. Pomoc mi go, pomoc mi go, pomoc mi go, pomoc mi go, era kak si sari, sari pipero, era kak si sari, sari pipero. Da šuti da verže, da šuti da verže, da bereš, 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 kak sakaš, da bereš, 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 kak sakaš, da bereš, 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 kak sakaš, da bereš, 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 kak sakaš.
Thank you.
Yes, right now, someone bearing a black t-shirt named Bane is going to come and magically reset the stage, as I understand it. So I want to say thank you, Bane, for having us here. Give it up for Bane. Woo! This is his awesome venue. Usually not open. Feel free to do that as I'm doing things or whatever. But I just wanted to say thank you for having us. This place is usually not open on Mondays, and they opened it up for us tonight. So please patronize the bar, tip them well. All the snacks you see laying around are for you to eat for free. So munch on some munchies. If you want to grab some pretzels, you can. This is your like 5-minute interlude to meet someone you don't know, tip a bartender, or read one of those delicious books on your in your area. And if you didn't get a book, there are more copies at the library and upcoming events. But you already have a book and you happen to have two, just put your extra back in that box before you go so that someone else can have it.
Excuse me, please. Excuse me. Excuse me.
Thank you. Fun and inviting.
Did you make a new friend?
I did.
Did you meet somebody? If you didn't, you have to. You did? Awesome. Of course you did. Word of mouth.
woman of the night who meets everybody. I love it. So we're in between music and written word. We are in between cacophony and silence. We are going to be in between Odessa, Ukraine, and the United States, in between Russian and English, in between poetry and prose and playwriting, in between genres, in between the lyric and the politic, in between language and image, in between native and non-native. I'm thinking this is disruptive, maybe, but I'm not sure. In between being seen and not seen, is that okay with you guys? You can lean around, I guess. Do what you need. In between spoken word and song, between greatness and more greatness. I have said in many of the venues where I've been sharing this beautiful book that you're about to hear sung to you, that Ilya Kaminsky is certainly going to be Poet Laureate. I say this like as if it's a big deal. It's not a big deal because he's won every award one could hope to win as a writer, in my opinion. He's inducted into the American Academy of Arts and Letters this year and elected Chancellor of the American Academy of American Poets. He won the Lannan Literary Fellowship, the Whiting Writers Award, the Ruth Lilly Poetry Fellowship, a 2019 Creative Writing Fellowship from the National Endowment for the Arts, and so many other awards for his two extraordinary books. He is a refugee, an immigrant, someone in exile from Ukraine, where he, as I understand it, was raised through being a teenager and was forced to leave as a Jewish Ukrainian person at that time, and now we're revisiting the struggles in that part of the world, and we also reminds us of struggles here. To me, being a teenager is the essence of in-betweenness, so maybe that's why in-betweenness strikes me as so relevant in your work, always being not on one end or the other of a binary. And I'm just so excited that you're here and so delighted to share your book with everyone in the room. When I wrote this NEA Big Read grant, you were in Atlanta at Georgia Tech. And I was so excited because it would be so easy to bring you here to Athens. And now he's so amazing that both our readers are now at Princeton. What? Georgia's second best institution of higher learning wasn't good enough for you? That's a go dogs moments. Can I hear it? Yeah, exactly. Well, Georgia's literary community doesn't easily want to let you go. We hope that you will forever occupy the in-between spaces between here, this state, and wherever the world draws you. My student, Sherry Thompson, are you in the house? She wrote that your book made her... Oh, I'm sorry, you don't like... Attention, don't look at her. I love that you wrote that the book made you feel dizzy. And Ben, drawing attention to you, said that it's an affirmation that through struggle, the best art is forged. Tonight, he welcomes us in between the pages of his incredible book, which you have in front of you. You can refer to the handout for the page numbers because he will sing it to you. And it's a different experience. I think he sings it to you. I love how you perform your work. And it's an experience. So follow along if you like in his beautiful book. Give the warmest applause for Ilya Kaminsky.
Thank you so much. I have to warn you right away, I'm not going to live up to this. So I might as well go back to wherever I came from. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah. Right, thank you. It's truly wonderful to be here, and I'm so glad and honored to be here. Thank you for your kindness and your grace. And if you haven't seen me perform, my goodness, I'm an amateur. Yeah. I saw you perform, a few months ago, and it was amazing. And of course, I'm very honored to be together with Katie, who is a much more superior poet. Take my word for it. Having said that, you all have noticed by now that I speak with a pretty heavy accent. So hopefully you all have a text to follow in your hands. I will leave the page number just so you go along, but they're also on the poster and on the wall. So hopefully nobody will get lost in between. We will all find each other in between, hopefully. Okay. Without much further ado, let me just read you some poems, okay? The first one on page 3 is called We Lived Happily During the War. We lived happily during the war. We lived happily during the war. And when they bombed other people's houses, we protested, but not enough. We opposed them, but not enough. I was in my bed, I know my bed. America was falling. Invisible house, I took a chair outside and watched the sun. In the sixth month of a disastrous rain, in a house of money, in a street of money, in a city of money, in a country of money, our great country of money, we forgive us, live it happily during the war. Right. So please follow the page numbers, otherwise you will know that I speak in a different language. The next will be on page 11, and it will be a story universe about a husband and wife, a pregnant woman and her young husband, who see a soldier shoot and kill a young deaf boy at a public gathering. And in response to that murder, they see the whole community decide to stand up and protest the authorities by refusing to hear them. Okay? You can get on page 11, but before I go on, I really I've been rude, I apologize. That was really an amazing performance before me, and I did a same thing. You guys were amazing. Page 11, Kamchatka. Our country is a stage when soldiers march into town, public assemblies are officially prohibited. But today, neighbors flock to the piano music from Sonia and Alfonso's puppet show in Central Square. Some of us have climbed up into trees, others hide behind benches and telegraph posts. For Peter, the deaf boy, in the front row sneezes. The certain puppet collapses, shrieking. He stands up again, snorts, shakes his fist at the laughing audience. An army jeep swerves into the squadron's gorging and so on. Sergeant disperses immediately! Disperses immediately. The puppet mimics in a wooden falsetto. Everyone freezes except Peter, who keeps giggling. Someone claps a hand over his mouth. The sergeant turns towards the boy, raising his finger. You! You! The puppet raises a finger. Then I watches her puppet. The puppet watches the sergeant. The sergeant watches Sonia and Alfonso. But the rest of us watch Peter lean back, gather all the speed in his throat, and lunge. And the sergeant, the sound we do not hear, lifts the gulls of the water. Page 12, next page. a soldier's march. Alphonse covers the boy's face with a newspaper. 14 people, monsters, strangers, watch Sonia kneel by Peter shot in the middle of the street. She picks up his spectacle, shining like two cones, balances them on his nose, observes this moment, how it convulses. No fuss, and the ducks run into the streets like mimics. 14 of us watch Sonia kisses his forehead, her shut a hole torn in the sky, and shimmer the park benches porchless. We see in Sonia's open heart the nakedness of the whole nation. She stretches out beside the little snowman, napping in the middle of the street, as picking up its belly, the country runs. Next page. Alphonse in snow. 13, page 13. Alphonse in snow. You're alive! I whisper to myself, searching for something in your leaf. Something runs down the street, falls, fails to get up, I run, etc. With my legs and my hands behind my pregnant wife, etc. Down Massacre Street, I run. It only takes a few minutes, etc. to make a man. Next page, 14. Toughness and insurgency begins. Our country woke up next morning and refused to hear soldiers. In the name of pity, we refused. At 6 a.m., when soldiers come in the girls in the alleyway, the girls slide by pointing to their ears. At 8, the bakery door is shut and soldiers Ivana face, so he's the best customer. At 10, Mama Gala chokes, no one hears you! On the gates of the soldiers' barracks, by 11 a.m., arrests begin. Our hearing does not weaken, but something silent in us strengthens. After curfew, families of the arrested come home and parties out of their windows. The streets empty, but for the squeaks of strings and the tap tap against the buildings, a footed fist and feet. In the ears of the town, snow falls. Alphonse stands answerable. Next page, 15. Alphonse stands answerable. My people, you were really something fucking fun. On the morning of the first arrest, our man, once frightened, bound to the beds, now stand up like human monks. Daphnis passes through us like a police whistle. Here the night testify, each of us comes home. Shots at a wall, at a stove, at a refrigerator, let himself forgive me. I was enticed with you. Life to you, I stand answerable. I ran, etc., with my legs and my hands, etc. I ran down the bus and got rid, etc., whoever listens. Thank you for the father of my time. Thank you for our album and that end. Thank you for deafness, Lord, such fire. From a march you never lit. Next page, 16. That map of bone and opening files. I watch the sergeant aim, the deaf boy take iron and fire in his mouth, his face on the asphalt. That map of bone and opening files. It is the area. Something in the air won't fast too much. The earth is still, that our God sent you conversant, which is his first day soldiers examine the years of bartenders, accounting soldiers, that we can send science, thus the soldiers. They tell Goras wife from her bed like a door off a bus. Observe this moment, how it convulses. The body of the boy lies on the asphalt like a paperclip. The body of the boy lies on the asphalt like the body of a boy. I touch the walls, feel the pulse of the hearts. A mystery of wordless and do not know why. I am alive, visitor of the city, Sonia, and I between Vidas and Gardens and the Rhode Island gates. Be courageous, we say, but no one is courageous. As a sound we do not hear lives the birds of the water. Next is page 23. Before the war, they made a child. Before the war, they made a child. I kissed a woman whose freckles are earth and apples. She had a mom on her shoulder, which she displayed like a medal for bravery. Her trembling lips, man can't do bad. Her hair, water falling in the middle of the conversation, man can't do bad. I walked in my barber shop of thoughts. Yes, I see the off to bear on the chair of my hairy arms. But parted lips, my parted lips lying under the cool sheets, Sonia, that the inks fitted. Page 22-0. Soldiers aim at us. They fire at a crowd of women flees inside the nostrils of storage lines. My God, have a photograph of this. In the piazza's bright air, soldiers track Peter's body and his head burns the stairs. I feel through my white shirt the shape of our child. Soldiers drag Peter up the stairs, and homeless dying Venus philosophers understand everything and bark and bark. Now on a breach with no camouflage of speech, a body wrapping the body of my pregnant wife. Tonight, if you don't die and don't die, the earth is still a helicopter I abuse, my wife. On earth, a man cannot sleep a finger at the sky. Because each man is already a finger flipped at the sky. Lullaby, page 27. Lullaby. Little daughter, rain water, snow and branches protect you. Whitewashed walls and neighbors' hands. Oh, child of my aprons, little earth of 6 pounds, my white hair keeps you asleep, lit. While the soldiers and while the child sleeps, Sonia undresses. Page 29. While the child sleeps, Sonia undresses. She scraps me until I spit soapy water big. She smiles a man should smell better than his country, such as the silence of a woman who speaks again, silence known. That silence is what moves us to speak. To throw my truths and graces in the air. I'm a deaf people and I have no country but a birth step and an infant and a marriage bed. Soaping together that is sacred to us. Watching each other's shoulders. You can fuck anyone. But with whom can you see it in water? Poem bombardment. My body runs in a realm of strength. My clothes in a pillowcase. I look for a man who looks exactly like me to give him my Sonia, my name, my chart. It has begun. Neighbors climb the trolleys at the fish market, breaking all their moments in half. Trolleys parts like intestines in the sun. Puzzle shot signs of fucking beautiful, I cannot stand it. Two boys still holding tomato sandwiches, hopping at trolleys light. Soldiers staring at their faces, their ears. I can't find my wife. Where is my pregnant wife? I, a body, an adult male, awaits to explode like a hand grenade. It has begun. I see the blue canary of my country, big breadcrumbs from each city's insides, big breadcrumbs from my neighbor's hair. The snow lifts the earth and falls straight up, as it should. To have a country so important, to run into walls, into streetlights, into love at once as one should. The blue canary of my country runs into walls, into streetlights, into love at once, the blue canary of my country watches their legs as they run and fall. Page 30. A cigarette. Page 30. Watch. Washington citizens do not know. They are evidence of happiness. In a time of war, each is a repetitive document of laughter. Watch, God! Death has something to tell that nothing they can hear. Clamber roof in the center square of this bombed out city, you will see. One neighbor zips a cigarette, another gives a dog a pint of sunlit beer. You will find God, like a damn pigeon's beak, I am pecking every which way at astonishment. Page 65. Firing squad. 65. On balconies, sunlight. I'm boundless, sunlight on our lips. Today, no one is shooting. A girl cuts her hair with imaginary scissors. The scissors in sunlight. Her hair in sunlight. Another girl makes a pair of shoes from a sleeping soldier, covered with light. A soldier's wake and gape at us, gaping at them. What do they see? Tonight, they shot 54 men at Lorna Street. I sit down to write and tell you what I know. a child. Learns the world by putting it in her mouth. A girl becomes a woman and a woman our body. They blame you for all things and say, sick in the body, for that not live in the body. Page 43. The townspeople watch them take Alfonso. Now, each of us, the witness stand, Vasenka watches us watch for soldiers throw Alfonso, Barabinsky, on a sidewalk. We let them take all of us, comrades, but we don't say, we carry in our suitcases, our coat pockets, our nostrils. Across the street, they watch him with fire hoses. First he screams, then he stops so much sunlight. A t-shirt falls off a clothes line, and an old man stops, picks it up, presses it to his face. Neighbors just stop to watch him thrown on a sidewalk like a body locked in a in so much sunlight. Each of us is a witness stand. They take Alfonso and no one stands up. Our silence stands up for us. And the last poem I'll read before I get out of your hair. It's the final poem in the book, and it will bring it a lot closer home. It's on page 75, and it's called In a Time of Peace. Okay. In a time of peace. Inhabitant of Earth for 40,000 years, I once found myself in a peaceful country. I watch neighbors open their phones to watch a cop demanding a man's driver license. When a man reaches for his wallet, the cop shoots into the car window. Shoots. It is a peaceful country. We pocket our phones and go to the dentist to pick up the children from school, to buy shampoo and basil. Ours is a country in which a boy shot by police lies on a pavement. For ours, we see in his open mouth the nakedness of the whole nation. We watch, watch others, watch the body of a boy lies on the pavement, exactly like the body of a boy. It is a peaceful country, and it clips our citizens' bodies effortlessly, the way the president's wife trims her toenails. All of us still have to do the hard work of dentist appointments, of remembering to make a salmon salad basil tomatoes. It is a joy, tomatoes and a little salt. This is a time of peace. I do not hear gunshots, but watch girls splash over the barriers of the suburbs. How bright is the sky. The avenue spins on the axis. How bright is the sky? Forgive me. How bright. Thank you.
forgive me, I am speechless. We are so lucky to live in this town so full of art, and we are so very lucky that Ilya Kaminsky fell in love with Katie Farris and that she is here with us tonight. No stranger also to in-betweenness, engaging in the rupture of binaries, fleshing out through memoir and poetry what it means to live in exile from the body as well as the body politic. Her work is amazing. Ilya placed Katie's book in my hands at a conference in March, and I think I might be just as in love with her as you are. I'm not sure. Her work breaks the bounds of genre and disrupts what we might consider to be a narrative of cancer, but swooning the reader also with the most compelling love story. Katie Farris is the author of the memoir in poems that many of you are holding in your hands, standing in the forest of being alive. Promise me this, cancer is everywhere and we need art to help bear the grief of it. If you're holding a copy of her book, would you please either share it with someone who's not lucky enough to be here to read it, or better yet, buy a copy and gift it to someone else in the future. Pay it forward. This is our gift to you from the library and the National Endowment for the Arts. It's so important. Please help that book have another life. If you didn't get Deaf Republic, I think we may have still some copies in the back, or no? No. Maybe not? No. But you can come to future events and you can also buy that book for someone else or share it. So if you happen to have more than one copy, please place it in the back at the end. But let's share these beautiful books. That book is from Alice James Books and also Liverpool University Press. I guess I don't understand that. I guess you have two presses, which is listed as Publisher Weekly's top 10 poetry books for 2023. It's definitely my top 23 and top lifetime book. It's so good. It's the NEA helped us to buy this gift for you that you're holding. Katie is also the author of several other books, including the hybrid form text, Boys, Girls, and several chapbooks, including A Net to Catch My Body in Its Weaving, which was winner of the 2021 Chad Walsh Poetry Award. Oh my God, you guys have won so many things. She's the winner of the Pushcart Prize. Her work has appeared in the New York Times, Granta, Atlantic Monthly, Nation, Poetry, the best places a writer could aspire to be published in. And both of them are translators. She is the co-translator of several books of poetry from Ukrainian, French, Chinese, and Russian languages. Most recently, The Country Where Everyone's Name is Fear. Now she's professor at Princeton. That's okay with us. You're here now. Give it up for Katie Farris.
Oh, hello everybody. How's it going? Good, good. You can imagine what it feels like always reading after Ilya. Just spend a minute with it. Standing in the Forest of Being Alive is a very new book, baby. It just came out on April 4th, so it's just a little over a month old. Thank you. It's not quite holding its head up yet. I don't really believe it's here. And I've certainly spent a lot of sleepless nights as I've been traveling around with it, so that feels a semi-appropriate metaphor. So basically the book follows, I was diagnosed with cancer in August 2020. So this follows from my diagnosis with breast cancer through to, I'm still in treatment now. But it follows kind of the what people most often think of as active treatment. So it follows through chemo, through surgery, and through radiation. This is called Why Write Love Poetry in a Burning World. To train myself to find, in the midst of hell, what isn't hell. The body bald, cancerous, but still beautiful enough to imagine living, the body washing, the body replacing a loose front porch step, the body chewing what it takes to keep a body going. This scene has a tune, a language I can read, a door I cannot close, I stand within its wedge, a shield. Why write love poetry in a burning world? To train myself in the midst of a burning world to offer poems of love to a burning world. So you may have never run across this word spiculated before. It's basically just doctorese for spiky, okay? Spiky wasn't good enough for them, so they had to, you know, Latinize it a little bit. A carcinoma is basically just any cancerous solid tumor. And Emily Dickinson's advice to poets was to tell it slant. Don't tell anything too straightforward, right? Tell it slant. You float in the MRI gloam, several spiculated masses. I name you cactus, carcinoma be damned. You make a desert of all of me. Have I said it slant enough? Here's a shot between the eyes. 6 days before my 37th birthday, a stranger called and said, "You have cancer, unfortunately," and then hung up the phone. I blame the pandemic for that abruptness of conversation. It wasn't quite that abrupt. I then said, "Can you give me any more details?" And she said, "No, someone will be in touch with you within the next 2 weeks." And so I got up. I cried a little bit first, to be honest. That was the first I'd heard of it. But I got up, I put on my clothes, I drove to the oncologist's office. I walked up and I said, "No, I don't have an appointment, but I'm gonna sit over there, and when there's somebody who has time, I'll see them then. And if nobody has time today, I'll come back tomorrow. And if nobody has time tomorrow, I'll come the next day." And this is when I began learning about how to advocate for myself medically, which is a skill which I didn't realize. I thought doctors or nurses or somebody would tell me what to do, but as it turns out, and some of them do some of the time, but as it turns out, a lot of that's on us as patients. And so I like to share what I can about that experience, because I think the people who need it most are often the people who are taught it least. So the front cover here, you might notice a certain resemblance in color between the hair and the braid. This is actually my braid and my scrawny arm. So if you can imagine, 2-3 years ago, I had a braid down to about my elbows. In the event of my death, what used to be a rope descending my vertebrae to the basement of my spine grows thin. In solidarity with my first chemotherapy, our cat leaves her whiskers on the hardwood floor. I gather them, each pure white parenthesis, and plant them in the throat of the earth. In quarantine, I learned to trim your barbarian hair. Now it stands always on end, a salute to my superior barbary skills. In the event of my death, promise you will find my heavy braid and bury it. I will need a rope to let me down into the earth. I've hidden others strategically around the globe, a net to catch my body in its weaving. The man you are, the boy you are. The man you are opens the door to your anguish, a mirror of my own. We've both grown silver around the eyes. But in your pocket, the boy you are brings me a melted candy bar. You issue commands like an old man, then take out my trash like a young boy with a crush. So my other love is biology. And occasionally I use a lot of biology and I think a lot about biology, and there are a couple of facts that just kind of blow my mind. The first one is photosynthesis, which I can't even start to talk about because I will lose my mind about it. Every time I think about it, I'm like, how? Another fact that does a similar sort of thing to me is just thinking about the fact that humans decided to stand up one day. Like, if you look at other bipedal animals, like kangaroos, their feet are enormous, right? Like, they are, relative to their height, they're like, you know, practically 90 degrees. And we don't have that. Ours are stupidly also small, which is probably why our backs hurt all the time. Physics really didn't intend for this usage of our feet. So this is called Outside Atlantic Cancer Care. I return to this point of wonder. What kind of animal began to stand on such small feet? And only two? What vertical absurdity, what upright madness. Perhaps we were imitating the trees, lifting our arms, wishing for roots, and then just forgot to set ourselves down on our four more rational feet. Our longing grew our fingers longer, twigs into branches. For if you long hard enough, do you not find fruit in your palms? I return to this point of wonder. Okay, this is, so I've got four brothers, no sisters. And they're all in the trades, manufacturing airplane parts. One of them is a plumber, one of them is a, doesn't matter. Anyway, they're all in the trades. chemo brain, as they say. So this is their favorite poem, quid pro quo, a dedication. You said we could replace our lumpy 20-year-old mattress if I wrote you a poem. So here's your goddamn poem. So there are, so I learned a fact from a poet, which is a little dangerous. I trust poets with a lot of things. I definitely trust them with words. There are some poets, a lot of poets, I think I trust my life with facts. So this is from Tomasz Szalamun, who's maybe a little less trustworthy than most when it comes to facts. But he said that Giotto, the painter, used his sketches of sheep in order to create his studies of angels. And so I've looked at a lot of paintings by Giotto after I found out this fact. I don't find anything particularly sheepish about the angels, but he told me, and now I am telling you. Next fact, Jonah is a character from the Talmud or from the Christian Old Testament, and he was a prophet, and he did not like the gig. It was kind of dark. And so one day he decided to run away. He was loud quitting. He wasn't fire quitting. He was fully running away to join the circus. And there was a huge storm, and he fell off the boat, and a whale swallowed him like they do. And while he was in the belly of the whale, he kind of came to terms with his gig. And so the whale vomited him up. So happy ending, right? Yeah. And finally, ambergris is this kind of grayish, amberish substance. And if you're ever walking down a beach, like in Savannah or whatever, and you find said substance, please give me a call. We will split the proceeds. What you found is ambergris, which is one of the most precious and exquisite ingredients in perfumery. It also happens to be whale vomit. And that's a poetic fact you can take to the bank. That is a real fact, real. A week before surgery, I practice my body. Like Giotto's angels, sketched from his studies of sheep, I open the jaws of my back to the sky, eating my body deeper into this blue. Like Jonah vomited from the whale, fragrant as ambergris, or plain as any woman who, a week before mastectomy, practices being opened. This is called After the Mastectomy, and it begins with a scene that really happened. At the oncologist's office, a man stares. I stare back until he says, "People must stare at you." Why bother closing a door when everyone demands it open? I go in the world with my tongue out and my shirt unbuttoned. My keys left in the lock, a 6-inch scar instead of a nipple. How can a watchtower hide? I am well positioned to seek out fires and invading hordes. My bald head, the beacon, the first alarm. I haven't read this one out loud, I don't think so. I'm gonna do that. This is called Woman with Amputated Breast at Her Mother-in-Law's Grave. One, a grave is a door we open. In my dream, his mother Ella curls into my body, bald as a breast. Two, what if the past is a crouching tiger and memory is the act of putting your head in its mouth? Three, thank you for the turkey I forgot to take out of the freezer, for your forgiveness and for the lamb in the deli drawer. Thank you for what eats and for the dead and for what eats the dead. All of us, whether fertile, whether fallow, fodder. Four, this elastic earth, with little ceremony, how it expands. Five, a grave is a door we open, lay our dead down in, begging like a key begs a keyhole. Thank you, grief, whose root is love, and love, which has teeth and eats. Okay, this is my mad poem. As you might imagine, after 3 years of cancer treatment, I've got a little bit of something in there. Zoladex is a medication that they give to people with ovaries who have hormone. I think it's only people with ovaries, but it's for people who have hormone positive cancers. And basically what it does is it shuts the ovaries down, because hormone positive cancers eat estrogen and progesterone and grow larger on them. It also comes in this enormous needle. It's like a small cannon, roughly. And it's like a pinball machine. There's literally a spiral inside of the, what is that called? The shot, whatever. And you pull it back and it bing, like you can hear it as it like propels this pellet of medication under your skin. It's quite something. And I never bothered to get the stuff that you put on top of it that makes it numb. It just doesn't seem to do much for me. But I've gotten quite a reputation for being very hardcore from the nurses, because I'm apparently the only one who doesn't do that. So this is called Woman with Amputation. So these I get monthly for the next 7 to 10 years, probably. And this is Woman with Amputated Breast Returns for Her Injection. Now I lack the muscle to pull me into the third dimension, but in these two, I can give you the world. 3 drains, 5 scans, $20,000. Come, doctor, how do you like me now? I never wanted to be anything but biddable. You see the outline of my shape? Fill it with your pencils, 7 points tickling me with color. I can. Watch me can. Watch me do. Watch me has. Watch me watch. This cancer patient has ambition. I scratch and scratch, and here we are, dancing the chart. When you give me that Zoladex shot, it's from one long needle and right in the gut. This is called Said the High Priestess to the Magician. So I've been a tarot reader since I was about 15. It served me well in dorms where I had nothing really fun to trade for things like cigarettes. But I could do tarot. That's what I could do, so that's what I did. The High Priestess is, she's the subconscious, she's the divine feminine, she's all that is unknown, she's all that's buried, she is the ocean. And the Magician is the one who manifests, the one who can make anything happen, the one who just has this ability to bring forth whatever he wants. Said the High Priestess to the Magician, I'm designed for alone, a lighthouse, I say. His arm around me, arabesque. He shifts adds the flourish of his other arm to my sans serif self. Smiles through my grump. He joys me. Reluctant, pulls laughter, that red, orange, violet, cerulean handkerchief slowly right out of my mouth. So this was sort of, it's getting close to the end of the book, also close to the end of my treatment. I was about 5 radiation treatments away from the end. So I'd completed my chemo, I'd had my surgery, and I'd done 25 radiation treatments. When my radiation oncologist pulled me aside and she said, "We've done a scan and there's something left in there. And I can't tell you what it is. It might be cancer and it might just be a little bit of an inflammation left over, inflamed tissue. But it's so deep inside of your shoulder that we can't do a biopsy on it. So you have 2 choices. The first is we could do a booster bit of radiation to eradicate it. The problem with that is it's gonna go through every major nerve and muscle in your arm. And because I already had nerve damage from my mastectomy, she said, you will have problems with that arm. I can't tell you how bad. It could just be a little bit of stiffness, or you might lose all feeling in the arm, or it might feel like it's on fire all of the time. I cannot tell you. I don't know more accurately. On the other hand, if you decide not to take that risk, and it does turn out to be cancer, then we can't radiate it anymore because you've gotten your lifetime dosage of radiation in that area. And we can't perform surgery on it because the skin is so delicate that it wouldn't heal afterwards. And my chemo is cancer, my cancer is chemotherapy resistant. So functionally, there would be no treatment left, which made it untreatable and eventually incurable. What do you want to do? And I said, can I have a couple days to think about it? And thankfully it was the weekend. And I did that thing I promised I wouldn't do, which was to ask her, what would you do? You know, what would you do if it was you or your daughter or your mother, what would you do? And she said, I have been up all night and I don't know. I couldn't tell you. This is as close to 50-50 as I've ever seen in my career. And I am always gonna be grateful to her for her honesty about that. I think doctors are encouraged in our world to provide answers even when they don't know. And she was willing to let her humility stand. So this is about making that choice to the God of radiation. Given the unexpected choice between uncertain death and certain damage, I find in the mirror a woman, breastless, burned, who, in an advisory capacity, asks, how much do you want to live? Enough? O God of radiation, let your light like a ship pass through me, your radiance exposing what's inside me like film a god takes. But must you clatter the eaves of my scapula, scurry the grasshopper nest of my heart, scythe my nerves and cobweb my muscles to the rungs of my ribs? How much more can one body take? Enough! Light every deadly cell like a wick burning in the paper lantern of my chest. My chest, a thing so ephemeral, yet held so firmly in your fist. And lastly, this is the final poem in the book. Do we have black squirrels in Georgia? Not so much, maybe. They're scattered throughout the country. Often, I seem to notice at like higher elevations, although I've never actually looked into it. But occasionally, when I read this poem, somebody will come up to me afterward and be like, as if they're telling me something I probably should know, Katie, squirrels are gray. Don't mean to like, but squirrels are gray. Like people, like panthers, sometimes squirrels are melanated. So black squirrels, yes. Secondly, penstemons are wildflowers. They're also called beard tongues, which is maybe the best compound word in the English language, beard tongues. And at least where I was in Idlewild, California, they were red. I don't know, maybe they come in other colors. And finally, Emily Dickinson, who's the ghost who kind of haunts this book, said that she knew that something was a poem when it took the top of her head off. What would root? Walking through a cathedral of oak trees and bristlecone pines, scolded by squirrels in their priestly black, their white colors wagging with the force of their scolding, I was struck simultaneously in both eyes by pollen or seed, some kind of flying detritus, and stopped to lean against a rock to scrub it, I thought, away. It was May, it was May, it was May, and the air was sweet with pine and island mountain lilac. The squirrels, I mentioned them already, etc., and the lizards ran down the spines of rocks like a bad feeling. I could see everything. Red-headed hummingbirds dipped their beaks into the little red hoods of penstemon, and I, a redhead, could hear everything. A red-crested woodpecker, who was not offended, I did not know his name. Everything smelled green. It was all green, really. Even the red was anti-green. And though my eyes ached from everything seeing, I could taste the granite in the spring. Oh yes, I drank water from the ground. I was wild even then, though the squirrels scolded me and tried to convince me I was not. Soon, I crested a rise. The land spread itself greenly for me, and I wished I had seed to toss into that green just to see what would root. My right eye would not close to this view. Why would it? But when I reached up to touch it, I felt a twig emerging and another from my other eye. That they were a part of my body, I could not doubt. They were living and enervated and jutting out. I sat down, feeling the hairs on the back of my neck for the first time, understanding they were not hairs, but roots. Everything was everything. The twigs in my eyes tasted sunlight with my mouth. The roots drew the salt from my sweat into their vacuum, and I was no longer hungry. Everything. It was all green. The roots in my skull shifted, and I laid down beneath my own branches. I had to wiggle a bit to find a place to lay my head. The rock was very hard, and I needed softer ground. Yes, a place for the top of my head to come off, to nuzzle into the earth, to drink. Thank you. I said, how do you feel about questions? And they said, yes. So I know you're burning with lots of questions, and I know that there's always like lots of time. So turn to the person next to you and ask a question so you're preparing while I get chairs, okay? And get ready to ask your question right away. Bring it up, Ilya and Katie Farris. Give them applause while you're thinking of your question. Bane, I might need help with that other mic, and I need one person to give up their chair. Oh, there's another one there?
Yeah,
oh, goody.
Okay. And I just bring it and it works. Oh, thank you so much. Oh, we can share.
Questions, concerns, complaints, declarations, absolutions.
Confessions.
Stories of tattoos.
actually the greatest story, but I will tell you what it is anyway. So these are leopards, and they are sharing whiskers, and they also kind of have tails that wrap around one another. It's actually a detail from an Art Deco building, and I found it in a book of like Art Deco, I found it in a book of Art Deco details in a library one time, and I was like, oh, maybe I really love that. That should be my tattoo. And then I foolishly put it back. And the next time I saw it was in a tattoo person's shop. My brother was there getting a tattoo of what I wanted to get tattooed. He saw it and he was like, no, this one's mine. And I'd brought the picture, you know, like it was, anyway. So I was a little bit resentful sitting there. I was like, maybe we'll have matching tattoos. No, I don't think we can have matching tattoos. But then the book was there and I was like, oh look, it's my leopard. So, you know, not the greatest story, but there's some interesting bit about there. Thank you. Thank you for the question. And yes, you can ask anything. It's AMA. It does not have to be poetry related.
I mean, everything is poetry related.
True. You don't have any tattoos, though.
Okay.
Yes.
What would be your biggest piece of advice for people trying to get into poetry? Okay.
What would be your biggest piece of advice for people trying to get into poetry?
Playing with words. I think the biggest challenge for people is language, literary language, whether it's poetry or other forms of literary language, is thinking that it's merely means of conveying information. Poetry is not just about an event. It is an event. And it becomes an event through images, through rhyme, inner rhyme, assonance, alliteration, and all other things. Similarly, if you think about painters, say, think about Marc Chagall. Chagall plays whole lot with bright green, curious red, and pale yellow, and also with cubism, and also with quite a bit of kitsch. And he makes a soup out of it in a way that is both challenging to your mind, but also somehow dreamlike. Or think of, I don't know, Rembrandt. Rembrandt gives support to it, sure, or mythological pages, but his true language is light and shadow. So the question would be, what would be the equivalent of your true language the way Rembrandt's was light and shadow? What it is about painting delivery on a page that makes you uncomfortable or makes you awake or makes you feel sensually alive? Lorca said, poet is a professor of five senses. He didn't say poet is a professor of creative writing at Princeton University.
I'm going to go quippy on this since he went longer, which is, if you can find something else, do that thing. And if you can't find anything else, don't give up. It's so excruciating. You know, like 90% of what I write is shit. Of the 10% that is not shit, maybe 1% actually gets made into poems. And of that, maybe 0.5% of that gets published. You know what I mean? And of that, you know, some minuscule percentage of that might get read by more than 5 people. You know what I mean? It's a tough business in that it is, oh yeah, and you'll never make any money off of it also, you know, which hopefully is not coming as a surprise. just don't give up. You just have to keep bashing yourself against the rocks, you know, and sometimes it's the greatest feeling in the world when it works. But yeah, if I could do something else, I would, but I know I can't because I've tried. Yes, my friend in the pink dress. How do we come up with poems?
Well, you walk down the street. You walk down the street, and you see you know, it was a May, it was Athens, people sitting on porches drinking tea, and they're shouting at each other some interesting stories from across the street. You walk down, somebody is talking to somebody else, perhaps a postman, but there is a cat walking by. And the cat is leaning a little bit, and the cat's tail is gone like this. And then the car goes really quickly by, and the grandmother on the pushes, not a good idea to go so quickly. You know what I mean? That's the language of images. Or maybe you come to a coffee shop like this one, and two fools are presenting butts away in the back, somebody is whispering something, and you're watching them, and you think, oh, that's the real theater. And you put the things down, and they become notes. And then one day when you have to say something, those notes may be the language for what you have to say.
I like the way things sound. I don't like the pictures so much. So I'll get something stuck in my head, like a net to catch my body and it's weaving, a net to catch. And I usually walk around and get stuck in my head like a song, you know, when that happens, and I can't get rid of it. And then I write it down, and then I just keep writing more things down until I think, maybe that's done. It usually isn't, but that's what I think. So for me, it's getting stuff stuck in my head, sounds. Thank you so much, that was a great question. Yes? How do we
make the films?
Oh, the films. The films, which films? What are we?
No, you refer to a specific film. Maybe Harry Potter, maybe.
Oh, you know what? I have no idea. It's sort of magical, though, isn't it? Like all the Marvel films. I don't know anything about them. Only poems.
One day, it's never too late.
It's never too late. Maybe we'll learn. Maybe you can tell me someday.
Katie, how's your shoulder?
My shoulder. It is tricky, but thankfully it doesn't feel like it burns every day of my life, so I've got that going for me. I don't have full mobility, and I don't have much strength sort of above here, and it does hurt quite a lot of the time. The burning is not a joke. I was like, oh yeah, that's what that means, nerve pain, gotcha. But it's livable with, and I think it was the right choice eventually, you know, that I made. Yeah.
How big of a challenge is it to translate a poem from one language to another? Does it lose anything? Does it gain anything?
The question is, how big of a challenge is it to translate from one language to another? Does it gain anything? Does it lose anything?
Well, if you want to translate the kind of poem Katie just described, but which is the kind of poem that sounds really good, you will have a hell of a time translating it. You will do a good job if you spend a lot of time and do a lot of music, but it's not going to be something you do overnight. I tried to translate Blake, Tiger, Tiger, Barney, Brian, in the forest of the night, what immortal hand the like of friends, I fear full symmetry. And you know, when you're young, your mother uses this poem as a lullaby, and then it's Tiger by Blake, and then you grow older and you realize what the hammer, what the chain, and what's fulminance, what thy brain, it's a poem of spiritual turmoil, what was my mom thinking, you know? But sound carries all that meaning. And when I tried to translate it into Russian, it was a poem about a big cat. It lost a lot of, whereas images are easier to translate because images are an international language. Let me give you a simple example. An image of like a young boy plays in a flute cow, from Horace, ancient Latin poet. It doesn't matter if you are in Mexico or if you are in Canada, you get it, and so forth.
I think one of the things that, aside from that, which is a good point, like Russian, for instance, is a very metrically based language. It's more like the language English was in Shakespeare's time. Ilya says, fighting words in our house, Ilya says that Pasternak's translations of Shakespeare are better than Shakespeare in English. And that is because the Russian language is sort of in that era of time. So it has more natural affinity. It feels fresher. It feels more contemporary, which, okay. Still fighting words. So there's that point. I think, too, one of the things we don't think as much about when we're not actively translating is the fact that some images actually don't translate well from culture to culture. So, for instance, I was translating a poem about somebody who, a young girl who was touching her mom with her foot, and it was a very tender moment. And I read it to a friend of mine who, where is she from? She's from the Middle East somewhere, I think Iran. And she was like, yeah, no, that's very disrespectful in our culture. Like, that is not, you don't even show the bottom of your foot to somebody. You know, you definitely don't touch people with your foot. And I was like, okay, we're gonna have to figure out something else. You know, so sometimes you're in a position where you have to change things really dramatically. Or we just translated a poem by Mayakovsky, and in that poem, he was making a little joke, a little pun about a breakup, and the line was something in translation. It was something like the bills. It's time for the bill to be paid, which isn't really a cliche that we have in English, and we were trying to come up with something that was punny and a cliche at the same time, and we came up with it's not you, it's we. Instead of, it's not you, it's me, if that makes sense. The copy editors, oh, they hate that so much. And I was like, I know, but I'm not gonna change it because it makes sense in the context of the punning that was happening in Russian. So it's a really interesting challenge when you really have to go entirely off text to translate the idea of something in the way that it is received in the other language. Exactly. Yeah, not just language, but culture, and yeah, absolutely. It's a fun challenge, though. Yeah.
Yeah.
How many languages do you speak, and have you written any poetry in languages other than English?
How many languages do you speak, and have you written poetry in languages other than English?
I was born in Ukraine, but it was still USSR. In a Russian-speaking city in Ukraine, which in itself is complicated. So the city was very Yiddish-influenced. That was my mother's first language and my brother's first language. So it wasn't really Russian. It was kind of a Jew's Russian in Odessa. But Ukrainian was the language we learned at school because we lived in Ukraine. Having come here, I realized that, you know, I could teach myself some other Slavic languages. And so I have some reading in Polish, but I wouldn't be able to speak Polish. Bulgarian I got a lot of. Macedonian as well. So it depends, but mostly Slavic languages.
Belarusian
is harder. When we translate either from Ukrainian or Russian.
And he has written poems in Russian.
Long time ago. Don't look for them.
I don't try to write in other languages. I've written, sometimes I work collaboratively with, like I speak a bit of French, but nothing even approaching what I could do a translation with. But I work together with Guijon, who's the French writer whom I translated, and I've worked together sometimes with whole groups of people, like the Chinese. I was sitting around a table with like four other translators and four poets, so we work together a lot of the time to create. So it's almost like an editorial thing. My job is to make sure it's received well in English, more than a lot of times with things like Chinese and French. Russian and Ukrainian, I have more skill to be able to actually translate. Yeah.
Well, you know, the King James version of the Bible, that was done by a workshop. There was a single translator. There was not a single translator. There was like over a dozen people. And you could still find some editions of the book where there's a discussion of that translation. It's fascinating. If you go even earlier, in let's say Western civilization, you go to something like Saint Jerome, and he was translating it into Latin, and it was highly political thing. You know, if God walks not this way but that way, you get your head chopped off.
Yeah.
So translator's life is very complicated.
There's a
a lot at stake.
Hi, you talked about the creative challenges of translation and, you know, choosing to not attempt to write in a different language even though you are bilingual. Would you ever say that, I mean, I would say obviously being bilingual expands your creative possibilities, but do you ever feel like it's limiting?
Do you ever feel like being bilingual is limiting?
As a writer,
specifically.
It can be. I think being human is very limited. Kafka said all language is but a poor translation.
I think that sometimes I do, the worst thing for me is sometimes I say I write from a sound. Sometimes I will mash up Russian and English together and there's a line that I really want to write, but I can't do that. You know what I mean? That's just too good. Doesn't make much sense. So that's my most frustrating thing. But by and large, I find that it has only really expanded and, you know, and made my poetic world, certainly, and my world in general, better. I am obligated by marriage to say that. So. But I mean it.
What did you say? I didn't hear.
Thank you. That's a fascinating question.
Alfonso and Sonia, are they real people?
Are Alfonso and Sonia real people?
I read fairy tales, but fairy tales are written for real reasons.
Absolutely. I was just curious.
I can elaborate, and I can say that if you read the book, in the second part of the book, in the first part of the book, Alfonso and Sonia die. In the second part of the book, there is a larger-than-life character, Mama Gaia, who steals the baby so that the baby survives.
It's ongoing.
Yeah, and you will see it here in the book as you look. That's the story of my father. My father was that stolen baby.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Any poems you make in a day?
Oh, wow, that's a good question. How many poems do you make in a day?
Not as many as Katie.
That's true. I
make
a lot of poems. Yeah, I do. I try in the morning to sit down and write a poem from beginning to end. And if I do that, then I can stop if I want to. But I try to keep going. And I try to do more than that. So I have a lot of bad poems, therefore. Thank you. Great question. Anything else? Oh, okay. Yeah, it's like this corner. I can't see. We'll start in the front and move to the back.
I read a different poem. I was interested in probably your poem, books to sequencing.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I know it's not chronological, but why did some of these things fit into where they did? For example, Gallia's toast. I mean, you know, why did it come there? Was any kind of logic or plan for the sequence?
How did you sequence the poems in Deaf Republic, especially because some of them are a little bit out of order chronologically? And he looked specifically at where Gallia's toast was in the book. Gallia's toast?
So can you speak a little bit about sequencing poems?
Yeah, you find the largest wall you can find, and you start beating your head against it, and you hope that the wall will break and not your head. You know, when I started writing the book, I thought I was a narrative poet, and by the middle I realized I really wasn't. But, you know, you keep going. Many ways to answer this question, how do you write a story, you know? I realized I had to kill a lot of people.
Yeah.
I mean, in a book. simply because, you know, in a story you fall in love with the characters and you have a crisis and then you go on, right? But I also, the story really changed it for me in a way because I realized that when I came to America, my first book, Dancing in Odessa, was very much in conversation with Ukraine, with being Jewish, with speaking Russian language, and By the time I was done with it, it was published. I lived in America for 11 years. And so I thought, okay, who am I now? Am I going to run around and play a Russian poet? Or what? Who am I? And I didn't have the answer. And partly writing this book was trying to find that answer. I knew that it would have to be in many ways about Eastern Europe, because, you know, we arrived out of our childhood in many ways. But it also had to be about the United States, because that's where I live now, and I didn't want it to be fake. And at that time, we moved to San Diego, California. That's before we came to Georgia. And what do you do when you're two writers and you move to another city? You go to Home Depot because, you know, you have a lot of books. You need nails for the wall to know your bookshelf. What happens in Home Depot in San Diego, California? You see a human being be dragged into an ice car simply because they crossed the border to make a buck. And their children are watching in shock. Because, you know, if you came for ice cream and they just say, I'm going to work for you, but then I'll buy you ice cream. And that's San Diego calls itself America's finest city. But what was curious for me is how similar the images were. You know, coming from Ukraine, what many in America, probably the third world country. I don't really believe which number of the worlds, but just reflecting back. And yeah, in the finest city in America, right? How do you consider those? And I realized, oh, I need to figure out first what kind of genre I'm going to write. That's why when there was a question if they're real people, and I said, no, write fairy tales. I realized that fairy tale is a correct genre. Because fairy tale can speak to more than one culture. When you have kids, you visit them, Hans Christian Andersen, even if you live in Georgia. So I figured, okay, I can do that genre. And in that genre, it doesn't have to be literal. You doesn't have to be narrative all the way. You can have backflashes. You can have dreams.
I'll also say, in the places where it's not chronological, often because I'm the narrative one in the family, so we would have fights about whether something should follow or go before or after. But oftentimes what he's looking for is texture and balance. You know, if there are too many love poems in a row or too many war poems in a row, you gotta mix those up. You know, if there's too many short poems in a row, you gotta put some long poems in. And that's equally important, I think, that kind of texture and the balance. It doesn't have to be balanced necessarily, but just keeping in mind as you're writing. So I think there are quite a few that are out of order, but that it's usually for that reason, I guess. But there were often times where we were actively...
Yeah, we were actively arguing. That's what two writers do in the marriage. But the truth is, Kenny was right. I just didn't... She was right to say that the story needs to have an order. However, when you say the story in poems, it also has to be lyrical at the same time. And at that moment when she was right, I simply didn't have enough poems to honor the story. I had to write many, many, many more poems and then pick only the ones that would accommodate the plot.
And specifically, you had to write the heartbreaking poems, and he did not want to write those, oh boy. I kept being like, something bad has to happen, babe, like, that's what the book is about. And he'd be like, no, once it starts, it will never stop. Which is also true of frickin' Eastern Europe, though. It's like, has this new war started, or has the old war never ended, you know? Anyway, there were some more questions in the back. Yeah.
Yeah, I was gonna ask, I feel like as a poet, you probably read a lot of poetry. What are some things other than poetry that you read that help you cultivate like a good sense of prose or words? Like, do you have any fictional authors or screenwriters or anything like that that help you write poetry?
So, what other genres do you read? What other books specifically that help you write poetry, like screenwriting or fiction or nonfiction, whatever? Yeah.
Oh, lots, all the time. I really eat other genres for breakfast. During the pandemic, for instance, I didn't want to read any poetry. I mostly read essays. Simply because I needed to escape, but not in a fictional world, because I didn't want any more crisis. I just wanted a little bit of conversation. Screenwriting was very useful simply because you can't really put any bullshit in that genre. You're naked on the screen and you gotta move. And that teaches you a lot about verbs in a poem, because in a poem, verbs is a screen director, right? So a lot, also other forms of art, like sculpture, teaches you a lot about cutting. Somewhere Michelangelo at first needs to find a medium. Is it wood? Is it marble? Is it iron? Then, okay, he settled down on marble, and he needs to find a David inside that marble, and then he keeps cutting towards that David.
Do you have a specific, any specific books that have helped you?
Oh, specific books. Again, Lance, I'm going to do a little PR here for a wonderful writer who lives in this town, Sabrina Watermarks. Who's a terrific writer. She combined genres, she combined your essay and fairy tale in a very interesting way. She and I both still...
The name of that book is Happily, that he's talking about.
Still, I think, from a writer named Bruna Schulz, who I also admire still from. And he's an interesting writer because he was an anti-fiction writer. He was trying to extend fiction into a poem as much as humanly possible. So I'm going to start with this too and see what it takes you.
My first book is hybrid genre, and I look to a lot of hybrid genre texts, which sounds more intimidating than I think it actually is, but like Italo Calvino's Invisible Cities, which is a book that I think every poet loves, or at least every poet maybe of my generation. And then, or like, Bachelard, what is it called?
The Poetics of Space,
is a wonderful book of, philosophy and.
Calvino, is it essays, is it a novel, is it a book of dreams, Invisible Cities by Ilya Kaminsky?
I already said that.
Oh, I'm so deaf.
Or N. Scott Nomaday's Way to Rainy Mountain. I mean, all those books have been really important for my poetry as well as other things.
Okay. I mean, we want to see more. We want to get you to fight a little bit.
It doesn't take much, actually. We've been on the road for a month. We will fight at the drop of a hat.
We have to leave. Isn't that awful? Can we, like, give the warmest round of applause?
Thank you, you're awesome. Great audience.
Thank you, everyone. Enjoy, read, share books, love each other, and have a good evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
That's so sweet. I was sitting with them like 2 hours.